Prof. Gert, who is the acting executive dean of the Faculty of Education. Then, of course, Professor Gert van der Westhuizen, our inductee this evening. And Professor Seshaba Mashlumaholo, who is our respondent, who is the Dean of Education at the University of Free State. We are really very privileged to have you here, sir. Distinguished guest and ladies and gentlemen, Sani Bonani, goeienaand, good evening, and to Bella. It is indeed a great honor and special privilege for me to welcome you to this professorial inaugural lecture of Professor Gert van der Westhuizen. As I do so, I wish to express a warm welcome to his loved ones, his special guests, and his colleagues from the Faculty of Education and also from the wider university. This is indeed a proud and joyful, yet a landmark moment for all of you, for Professor van der Westhuizen and of course for us here at UJ. Inaugurations, many a times pompous and decadent, but hopefully most dignified, well-meaning, we are told, date back to ancient Greece as the opportunity for formal investiture of a person into high office, and it marks the formal assumption of office or position of authority. And so today is that day that marks the rite of passage and the entry of Professor van der Westhuizen into the distinguished community of university's most senior scholars. It is indeed an office and a position of authority and leadership which we shall not assume lightly. I am reminded that inaugurations usually follow well after the actual appointment to the role or post, and are often a test and an indication as to whether the incumbent still finds the now somewhat older role or office as interesting as at the time of the interview. And so we shall observe Professor van der Westhuizen tonight with more than an ordinary level of interest, Gert. I remarked earlier that the professorial inauguration is as important to the incumbent and their loved ones and colleagues as it is to the university. I say this since the inaugural lecture is as much a reflection on the state and the intent of the contemporary university and how it measures up to Professor van der Westhuizen's inaugural lecture on cognitive justice and learning interactions. I'm also reminded that very few books are available in bookstores on what it is to be a professor, and in particular, what the freedoms and duties of this most senior scholar of the university is. In this regard, I offer you the reflections of Bruce McFarlane, who in his book, Intellectual Leadership in Higher Education, Renewing the Role of the University Professor, seeks to correct this oversight and argues convincingly that given the corporatization of the research agenda, professors must reclaim professorial leadership and that they thus occupy a very special role in the university. Specifically, McFarlane argues that two freedoms, namely that of critic and advocate, was essential for professors to execute their four duties, being those of, first of all, mentor, secondly, guardian of standards, thirdly, enabler of networking and mobilizer of resources for others, and fourthly, ambassador for the institution or discipline. So this evening, we will have only one small insight into how Professor van der Westhuizen responds to this call for the return of professorial leadership. Let me now invite the acting dean of the Faculty of Education, Professor Gert, to introduce Professor van der Westhuizen to all of you. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Berger. Before I start, just on a personal note, Professor van der Westhuizen, it's a special honor for me to officiate tonight in the position as acting dean, also because I regard you and hold you in a very high esteem as an academic. colleagues and friends, Gert van der Westhuizen is a professor of education in the Department of Educational Psychology at the University of Johannesburg. He's married to Leonie and they have four sons, Jaco, Rian, Gerard and Etienne, and six grandchildren, two boys and four girls. Gert grew up in a working class family in Van der Bijl Park and he's a first generation graduate, the eldest of three sons who all hold doctorates. He was originally educated as a language teacher at the then Potchefstroom University of Christian Higher Education in the Northwest, where he completed the M.Ed and D.Ed degrees. Gert started teaching Afrikaans in the Technical High School in Potchefstroom in 1976, and he worked as a language researcher of RAU from 1979 onwards, and the teacher educator at Potchefstroom University, and NGO coordinator of in-service teacher education programs at the Center for Community Development of Vista University from 1991 to 2004, and since then he has been an associate professor at RAU. And of course, that status has now changed. Gert is an educator with a passion for studying and learning, and has developed experience in teacher professional learning, school learning conversation, and conversation analysis methods. Teaching specialization include theory perspectives of learning, research supervision, qualitative methodologies, and conversation analysis. A priority for him is to make explicit links between research work and teaching. This is evident, for example, in the M.Ed programs he initiated and designed, the M.Ed at Vista University in Cognitive Education and the M.Ed at UJ Psychology of Learning, drawing on insights from research work. As teacher educator, he has worked in programs at three SA universities and a staff member of the university-based NGO Center for Community Development, where he was a facilitator and researcher in teacher in-service programs in seven provinces. He was also inspector of teacher colleges in Zimbabwe for 2 years, appointed by the University of Zimbabwe. As far as service work is concerned, Professor van der Westhuizen has done service work as evaluator of research proposals, WIRTS NRF, journal articles, more than 10, and the evaluation of masters and doctoral students of most universities in South Africa, including Leiden University and Alakapa University in India. He was also external co-supervisor of PhD students at the UNW and CPUT. Gert has been actively involved in the work of academic associations, including the African Evaluation Association conferences in Senegal and Niger. He's also serving for a second term in the executive of the South African Education Research Association. Gert has also worked as invited participant on the panel for the NRF to review the IKS programs and strategies in South Africa. In 2015, Gert was invited participant in the Arusha Conference in Tanzania on the role of universities in the Education for All movement. He's also an invited participant in the conferences of the Saatchi Chair in Development Education, Prof. Odora Hoppers at UNISA, and services on the editorial panel of the Taproot series of publications of UNISA. His academic work has been acknowledged with several awards and grants, including for postdoctoral studies at the University of Michigan and the Fulbright Scholarship for Research at UMass Amherst in the USA. Since 2000, he has presented more than 33 conference papers at conferences nationally and internationally. He published 15 books and book chapters and more than 30 articles in accredited journals. The most recent book, Mentoring for Learning, was published by Sense Publishers of Rotterdam and is the culmination of 5 years of research work on mentoring for learning with Prof. Harm Tillema from Leiden. The co-editor of the book was Kari Smith from the University of Norway. The book is a research-based text and includes 7 chapters with UJ staff and students and 10 from universities internationally. More than 30 master students and 8 PhDs have completed their studies with Professor van der Westhuizen as supervisor or co-supervisor. Of these, more than 12 students have recently graduated with studies on elements of learning interactions and conversation analysis. Gert is committed to the development of languages in academic work, having participated in the growing of Afrikaans as an academic language. He is still writing best pieces in Afrikaans, the latest published by Litnet Academic in 2015. Leerspraak en Mentor Acties, Learning Talk in Mentoring Interactions. This article contains examples of nutskeppings, which we translate to newly coined Afrikaans words, for technical terms such as epistemic primacy or kennis voor opstelling. Gert's main research interest in topics of learning, a research footprint, will hopefully, in the long run, be seen as working towards the broader research agenda of the transformation of education in South Africa. As the core of transformation is the changing, what is happening in interaction between and among teachers, lecturers, and learners or students. If these interactions can become more open, recognizing conversational norms and practices, then significant advances can be made in education. I thank you.
Thank you very much, Acting Dean Professor Luke, for the kind introductions. Acting DVC Academic Professor Berger, ladies and gentlemen, I am very pleased to be here, and I need a minute or two just to see how the seating is done, so that in case I am keen to do some group work this evening, I can know how to organize the venue. And then the next thing I have to do is to figure out, I have to switch it on first. Yeah. There you are. Oh, there you are. Thank you very much. Well, we live in hashtag times. What started with fees must fall is becoming the curriculum must change. And much more. This we have realized at the SAERA conference 2 weeks or so ago, where as researchers in that association, we all really realized that something is happening. Things are busy changing, and students are again the agents of change, so we saw in 1976. Challenges include, of course, problems with curricula, the relevance of knowledge, and decolonizing the contents of research, teaching, and learning. This is all about the need for cognitive justice. My opportunity this evening is to share a review of what I've been working on as an educator and as a researcher. This talk is my inquiry into the problems of learning, given poor learning attainment, and concerns about knowledge in education. What actions can be taken to improve learning, and what really is the problem, and what are the challenges of cognitive justice in this regard. So my focus in the work I do, the research work I do, is on learning conversations. as places where educators and researchers can consider their responses at the level of practice. Now, this is not working for me. If I can, I have to look over there and then, all right. Is this okay? All right.
Okay.
And then, you know what, I'll just do the page down. Okay. Thank you. I should say friends or ladies and gentlemen, especially family members, my studies of learning come a long way. I started with M&D studies on vocabulary learning and school learning performance of black learners, following the standard those days of scientific work in the positivist tradition. Findings those days were taken as facts that are true. And you won't believe it, for a master's study I did a true experimental design, pre-test, post-test, study in Morris Isaacson in Soweto. And for PhD, I did a study of grade 12 exam performance and how that kind of exam performance can be predicted using multiple regression models. So I was quite steeped into using statistics those days, but since then I moved on. Work in the context of non-governmental organizations in in-service programs followed, and my research focus there was on teacher learning through action research from critical theory perspectives. Since my appointment at REU in 2004, my research on learning focused on collaborative learning and studies of interaction settings, shifting from the what and how of learning as observed, reported, performed, and in questionnaires to learning in and as interaction. So there was a shift in my work, moving away from cognitivist perspectives about learning to interactional perspectives. So there's a clear change in my research work. This really means that in the old days, you did research on learning by doing pre-test, post-test, observation-type research. And I have learned that there is much more than doing research in that way, much more in the idea of interaction, and that a lot of learning happens in interaction. Therefore, you need to take a different perspective when you do this kind of research. Now, my focus on conversations was really inspired by life conversations, I could say. Conversations with children, conversations in classrooms, and also in professional settings. For example, let me mention two or three. I had the wonderful opportunity to walk next to the Hennops River with twin boys, and we had a grandfather-grandson's outing. And that was really wonderful. And at some point, one said to me, "Well, there is a mystery." Yeah. I said, "Okay, well, the mystery is you have the river, and somehow the water goes back and comes down the river again. So how that's a mystery. How does that work?" So, of course, as a trained geography teacher, I was really able to explain everything about cloud formation and water vaporizing and the raining over there, and I could explain all of that. And then the second son said, "Well, there's a greater mystery." He said, "You know, when you think about God, who is his father and mother?" So there we had a conversation next to the river, and I had the difficulty of these mystery questions. And of course, we really know that grandchildren can be very patient. You know, they are still waiting for my answer. Or let me say instead that the conversation continues. Mm. It's a lifelong one, and it is about knowledge in the family. It is about knowledge in in that interaction where you have the privilege of conversing with your grandsons. And then we had the opportunity to have a conversation with Jan van der Westhuizen. He is my namesake, who is a traditional healer in Kalahari, a Khoisan healer. And we had the chance to meet four grandchildren and I. We met with Jan, and we had very interesting conversations about life in the desert and what it means to walk on sand and the different kinds of sand that you get and what it really means to know elephants and how the animals in the desert would perform if there's rain coming. So that was a wonderful conversation with little ones and namesake Jan about, I would say, lessons of life, if you like. So I am actually inspired by the opportunity to have conversations and to learn from them. I want to welcome my colleague, Professor Hoppers, and her colleague from Sweden. You are most welcome. I know you got into other traffic that I got into, I'm sure. You are really welcome. I was just relating some stories about my interest in conversations and how important it is to value conversations. I could also tell you about other stories, for example, how professors let students miss out on learning in their conversations. So when I observe such opportunities, I really am keen to continue studying learning conversations, how they work and what we can, how we can benefit from them. We have been doing quite a lot of conversation analysis research here at UJ, and I thought I should just mention some of these studies that we have completed. I'm very pleased to see quite a number of our students who actually participated in these studies and who did most of these studies here in the audience. And I'm not going to go into much detail except by just highlighting the broad categories of conversation studies. So we did some studies in reading classrooms, social media settings, life orientation classrooms, and also in professional learning settings. We did some classroom learning support interaction studies. Our students were quite interested in studying class settings where learners are discussing difficult topics. And we have learned a lot about how conversations are organized when it comes to talking about difficult topics. Then we also had a few studies on learning and counseling conversations on gender-based violence, a mother-daughter talk about sexuality, and an adolescent girl conversing in a session with a traditional healer. This is quite a spread of studies, and our learning from these interactions are quite remarkable, and I would like to share some more detail about this later on. So the other broad strand of studies that we have completed includes studies about professional learning. And there we focused a lot on how mentors interact with students in our Faculty of Education. And the question we ask all the time is, if you observe such learning interactions, what are they about on a level of content, but also how are they conducted? And when you look at how the conversations are conducted, from a conversation analysis perspective, you would focus on status, the status of participants, the stance taking and how the stance taking varies, how the interaction is organized in terms of sequences, and how mentors use conversation strategies to make space, to repair, if something is said that does not take the conversation forward, and so on. So another focus there is knowledge access and responsibility. And quite a number of our studies with mentors had that focus. I'm quoting briefly a range of the findings from these studies. And then in the interest of time, maybe I should say that we've done studies on mentoring conversations the last 5 years, and that culminated in a research-based text, Mentoring for Learning, co-edited by Harren Tillema and Kari Smith. We are quite proud of this outcome of our research work, and the text is getting international attention. Now, the topic that I have, cognitive justice in learning interactions, is actually quite a complicated topic. There is much to this, and I wanted to take you just through two steps looking at this topic. First, to get some understanding of the concept of cognitive justice, and then after that, look at learning interactions, what they are about, how they are, how they can be understood, and what learning interaction research we have seen around, and then try to bring the two together to ask the question, when it comes to the imperative of cognitive justice, what are the responses that educators may consider? So for everybody in the audience, I'm quoting dictionary descriptions of the word cognitive. And you know the word cognitive is about learning and knowing. It is about how we know and perceive things. The Sesotho Nano refers to thought processing. The word justice, you know quite well, is about fairness, advantage. And the Sesotho words bring meanings which is about saving, salvaging, and doing things that are parallel and equal, and of an equal distance. The latter definition I'm benefiting from my colleague Zulu Matawa Zulu, who is into mathematics, and when he talks about translating words in terms of equivalence, the interpretations go all the way to mathematics and try to make a connection there. So one could say that just in terms of the terminology, cognitive justice is about a fairness of knowledge, knowledge rights, treating knowledge in ways that are fair, saving, salvaging, thought processing to be equal and of the same distance. So, so far, the idea of giving some content to the terminology. But what I want to go beyond that, and I want to share with you the extended conceptualizations that you may come across when you study the literature on cognitive justice. And I want to quote Visvanathan, one quote from him and his views about cognitive justice. He is a social activist, academic from India, and wrote about cognitive justice as a challenge in the Indian community in India. And it is about the changes in that country over time after colonization and the need to for the society in India to work with knowledges that are treated equally and fairly. So here's the quote from Visvanathan. Do you want to read that, and then I can just emphasize one or two elements of the quote? Well, cognitive justice is the right of every individual or group to pursue and perpetuate the forms of knowledge that their ways of life depend upon. The right to pursue knowledge that their ways of life depend upon. It seeks to protect the group from modern Western science or any other form of knowledge that seeks to hegemonize, eliminate, or museumize it. So those are very strong words saying that we have that there is a Western tradition of science, a Western knowledge industry, if you like, which is about ignoring other knowledges in society. And what happens is that the Western tradition is hegemonizing science knowledge in many ways, and at the same time eliminating or museumizing, putting into museums knowledge that are community-based, knowledge owned and lived in by communities. So let me move on and offer an additional and an extended conceptualization of cognitive justice. It is about the right of different forms of knowledge to survive creatively and sustainably, returning to life indigenous knowledge systems, restoring their place in the livelihood of communities so that they can, without coercion, determine the nature and pace of development they require. So the emphasis on different forms of knowledge and the right to survive. My colleague Professor Hoppers wrote much about indigenous knowledge systems. She was also instrumental in formulating IKA's policies in the country and is taking this work forward. The emphasis and the work on cognitive justice, taking that forward as part of her work at UNISA. Knowledge rests in people. And for Africa, the challenge has to be that of how to build on local knowledge that exists in its people and as concomitant to working with global knowledge and information. So it is about building local knowledge and also doing that in global context. So I want to just pull out the emphasis, I think, without underestimating the call for cognitive justice, that this is about knowledge rights. It is about knowledge dominance, knowledge articulation, knowledge possibilities, and knowledge growth. It is about the rights of knowledge systems and knowledge workers, that is citizens, to live, grow, and benefit from their knowledge. The survival of our democracy depends on how education can do justice to knowledge inclusion and dialogue. So I'm sharing with you brief conceptualizations of what cognitive justice is about. And I'm realizing that I'm doing this perhaps as a way of indicating that any inquiry about cognitive justice can start with conceptualizations like these, but there's a whole universe, there is much more to the notion of cognitive justice. It is an imperative of educational change in the country, and it is not to be treated in a technical and reductionist way. Now, having said that, I want to move on and say a few things about learning interactions. And I want to do that by summarizing some of the research that I looked at about learning interactions and how learning conversations form certain dimensions of learning in interaction. And I have decided to use, to not go for the bullets, but to go for the hashtags instead. So please, I noted a few, I think, inspirational points about learning interactions. In fact, when we learn in interaction, that is quite a special thing. It is about coming into presence. If you meet with another human being, it is about coming into presence. It is about the opportunity for people to show who they are and where they stand, and to give careful attention to see, to hear the other. Interactions, learning interactions, are also dialogical practices. And Freire taught us a lot about how those dialogic practices are emancipatory and how they can be. And we still have to stay with Freire and his idea of learning as a dialogic activity. To live means to participate in dialogue as a way of seeking the truth, Bakhtin said. So to live means to participate in dialogue. Learning is an orientation to truth, where finding truth is the outcome of collective processes of learning and discovery. Learning interactions are about the I and the other. When you and I meet, when you and I meet for purposes of learning, or in any case, when you and I meet, it is about the I and the other. It is about the ethical and reciprocal responsibility with the other as the primary, and I not being able to exist without the other. So Levinas said, made these, I think, beautiful statements about meeting another human being as about being about the I and the other, and that all the ethical responsibility that goes along with that. In a way, he's saying, when you meet, there's a responsibility. So as a traditional teacher, you can't just meet your class, carry on, and get it over with. The meeting, the interaction, is a serious event. It is a serious responsibility, and it has so many dimensions that we have to and can rediscover in our changing education context. Now, here are some academic notes of studies about learning interactions. And they capture, I could say, some of the features of learning interactions. Well, when we interact, it's mostly institutionally based. This means that the way you interact in a classroom, in a lecture hall, in a taxi, the way you interact next to the end observer, the interactions, they are institutionally determined. And the approach, the participation, are really influenced by the status of the participants and also the social norms of the interaction. Learning interactions are public, accountable processes. They are public processes. They are, when you meet, even if you meet with one learner, it's a public engagement, and there's accountability at stake. It's also locally occasioned, if I can quote some of the CA sources. CA refers to conversation analysis sources. And when people say it's locally occasioned, it means it's a learning interaction now, locally, here. And it is not this, and will not be the same tomorrow or 10 minutes later. It is locally and occasioned. Koshman talks about learning in and as interaction. So in an interaction there's learning, but the learning is also used for the interaction. In such interactions, conversation practices play an important role. We do lots of things in conversations. We take turns, we make utterances, then the utterances are organized in certain ways. There are sequences of utterances. So if I start with a question and answer, then the sequencing may change. So when you do research on learning interactions, That is an important unit of analysis to look at. Now, what the important thing is to realize here, that all conversation practices do social actions. So in a learning interaction, anything you say is actually a social action. Any practice is a social action. So, for example, if I ask a question, the question does the work of inviting, exploring, confronting. Or if I give advice, well, giving advice is doing a lot of work in an interaction. I'm wondering why. I give advice to you. What is the work it is doing, the advice giving? Well, it is saying, you don't know. I think I know. Let me tell you. So the conversational action of, the conversational practice of advice giving does all sorts of social actions. And then if we have a conversation and I interrupt the conversation, the interrupting does a lot of social action, a lot of social work, and it's communicating all sorts of messages. So when we do conversation analysis research, we look at practices and how the social actions that they do. This slide continues to explain some of the features of learning conversations. And it refers to the importance of understanding and learning in an interaction. Now, of course, you know that when we have a conversation, there is understanding. And the conversation can continue because there is some understanding. Unless if there's no understanding, then the conversation will stop. But understanding is a basic element of interaction, of conversation. People do understanding in different ways. And at different levels. And then, of course, learning in from an interactional perspective is not about using what you have in mind and saying what you have in mind. Learning in, from an interaction perspective is saying that it is an achievement that is interactional. So it's not as if I have all these things in my mind, and therefore I say some things. So what I'm saying is not even a window into my mind. Learning is discursive, it is interactional, it is interactive, and that means we learn together because I said something and you said something. And that exchange developed, let's say, in terms of response preferences, up to the point where there are some changes in orientation, or where one participant would say, okay, I think I look at things differently now. That could be an indication of learning, or changes in the organization of participation. I want to say less, I want to say more. Learning is observed interactionally in different ways. And then there's lots of research about different conversational tokens of learning. And in my that's not a handout, that is in my booklet, you'll find quite a number of references to how learning is accomplished interactionally. Now, a lot of the conversation analysis research looks at knowledge and the importance of knowledge. In fact, there are some very interesting books about the morality of knowledge in interaction. And it is about how participants use what they know when they interact. And that's a normal conversational thing, isn't it? We meet, we talk about the rain. I say what I say because I know some things about rain and difficulty and frustrations in the traffic. We have differences in knowledge to the point that we can identify that some participants are more knowing than others. So in the literature, people distinguish between a knowing participant and an unknowing participant, and how that is defined and how that actually affects the whole interaction. And now, of course, already you can get a hint here that if you want to talk cognitive justice, then this idea of being a knowing or an unknowing participant is something that you really have to question and take a closer look at. Knowledge identities are formed in conversations, and knowledge, the identities are parts of, they make part of knowledge authority. So if I'm the knowing one, then I have the authority, and that plays out in our interaction. Now, I wanted to offer you some illustrations of the studies we did at UJ, illustrating some of these features of learning conversations. And I'm now tempted to say this is for next class, but I'm not going to. I think I'll take a step back and then maybe just pick on one or so. Khobolele khwa shikinya, that is talk that moves. So in an interaction, you have shaking interactions. And we have this very beautiful study where grade 12 boys had a session with their counselor on gender-based violence. And the conversation developed very in an interesting, up to an interesting point where the one boy just jumped up and said, no, men are not violent. Men are not violent. So for the group, that was a shaking utterance. That was disturbing the flow. That was pulling the attention back to changing the topic even. It is very interesting how such utterances, how they occur, what, you know, what would it take to build up to such interactions, and what happens afterwards. The study of the conversation between a traditional healer and an adolescent girl was a very interesting study. What our student found there was that actual flow of the conversation is totally different from other similar conversations, and the utterances that, you know, what was said by the traditional healer was done in such a way that it is also totally different from other such interactions. So the conversation practices in that interaction, they were good examples of claiming truths in metaphorical, melodical, and praise song terms. So it was a rich interaction, full of metaphors, full of beautiful language, opening the door for us to have a different understanding of how learning and counseling interactions work. Now, I have here slide of a transcription, and I don't really want to belabor the point, but this is just an example of how in our conversation analysis research, we would do videotaping and then do the transcription and then analyze the transcription in terms of different sets of analytic principles, if you like. This was a situation where the mentor worked with the student and they spoke about note-taking in classrooms and how that works. I have a fuller account of this transcription in the booklet, so I want to maybe just emphasize to illustrate how such analysis can work, that in this example, in those lines, you see mentor questions indicating the mentor's stance. And stance, by the way, in conversations, that's something that changes over time. So right now I can have a stance, I know. But two utterances later, my stance can be, no, I don't know, or I know less, or you thought you knew. So mentor questions in this example were quite clearly indicating stances and how the mentor did inviting, challenging, and confirming authority. The student in those lines did accounting, claiming agreement, extending an understanding. The mentor did affirming of the stance and support and approval of the student. And then lastly, it seems that the student response preferences to Q&A sequences show the accomplishment of learning. So the abstract that I included, the last few lines, there's the learning in terms of this analysis. And what we tried to do with this study is, what was the build up to this point of learning, and how was the talk organized up to that point? Now, here is the opportunity for me to try and bring the two together. The few points about learning interactions and how they work, and then also the initial conceptualization of cognitive justice. Of course, the question when it comes to thinking about cognitive justice is about what happens in classrooms, what happens in the meantime. So I thought in the booklet I have a whole outline of how this can be conceptualized, but I thought I should explain two scenarios just to make the point. The scenario A, teaching a lesson, teaching the definitions, the lesson was about healthy living. This was a life orientation classroom, grade 7. So it was a typical lesson, teaching definitions of health, maybe some worksheets, self-assessments, guidelines, what to do and what not to if you want to live a healthy life, and perhaps also a biology section on healthy body and how that works, and how that can be understood, especially in terms of the textbook of life orientation. Now, a scenario B could be a scenario where you could observe the educator talk doing the work of inviting, exploring, claiming, accounting. So in such a lesson, question then, what is the talk doing? What is the educator talk doing? And in such an alternative scenario, you could get the educator talk doing the work of inviting, exploring, claiming, making knowledge claims, inviting participants to make knowledge claims. And accounting of diversity of knowledge as knowing participants, talking about their lived experiences, community views, beliefs about health, healthy living. So the scenario B is about using talk to foster diversity of knowledges, but not in a technical bridging sense, but in the sense of, in the full sense of knowledge. What does it really mean to live a healthy life in a community? This means then, in this scenario, you are not stuck with the textbook definition of healthy living, but you want in the classroom to promote the diversity of knowledges in the fullest sense of the word. So you would also include conversational practices of rewarding knowledge diversity, ways of knowing. Knowledge as community knowledge connected to livelihoods, ecologies of life, determining life chances owned and used by people because their lives depend on it. Here is a big jump, an important jump, that when we talk about knowledge in this lesson, it is not just knowledge as in the textbook, but it is knowledge, community knowledge, connected to livelihoods. So when you talk healthy living, well, community knowledge about that is connected to livelihoods, to ecologies of life, and to determining life chances. So you know, your lesson about healthy living, if you draw on community knowledge, you know, what does that have to do with determining life chances? To the extent, you know, that the knowledge is owned and used by people because their lives depend on it, which makes it quite a serious venture, according to Visvanathan. Then, in this lesson, of course, the educator talk will also confirm learners' knowledge rights. The educator will be sensitive to that possibility, in fact, to that need and imperative that learners have knowledge rights, and that they also have the responsibility to exercise those rights. So, in the case of this scenario B, learner talk is about showing knowledge rights, doing uptake. This is a conversation analysis term that in any conversation when we talk, I may see that you are just not doing anything with what I'm saying. There's no uptake, right? But you have to have uptake. If there's no uptake, if you don't do anything with what I'm saying, then we're not going anywhere conversationally. So learner talk, in my understanding, needs to show uptake. It needs to show understanding and justifying doing understanding. And I'm a quick reference to speech communities, which is the challenge that we have speech communities in classrooms. How are they formed, and how can they come into participating in a typical lesson like this? Chair, how much time do I have? Can I take another 10 minutes?
Of course, yes.
All right, yeah. Thank you. All right, there's a second scenario. And this is an honors class on theories of learning. And I do the same thing here, a scenario A, which is the traditional lecture approach teaching learning theories. This is a kind of scenario that happened in my class. And then I took a different look at this setting and worked out a scenario B where educator talk is doing the work of encouraging multiple knowledges and the similar kind of scenario that we had in the previous lesson. The difference here is that one could make use of inquiry-based conversations where you actually set up the lesson in such a way that participants would have to do an inquiry in their own experiences and discover moments in their own experiences where they learned about an important question. Like in this case, maybe the question, can one talk about community theories of learning? And that would open up, I think, a lot of very meaningful discussion in this lesson. Now, I'm working towards a close here, closing my talk. I want to make the point that that when you take a conversation analysis perspective, that there are quite a number of concepts that are relevant for pursuing learning interactions and cognitive justice, but there are also some very interesting questions for further inquiry. And I'm noting those on this slide. And I'm realizing that they are a mouthful. But the concepts, most of these concepts I've already referred to, and I am suggesting that these concepts may be useful in considering how the imperatives of cognitive justice can play out on levels of practice. I would like to just for a brief moment refer to how I see the implications for teacher education. And in the booklet I have a number of possibilities. Here I just wanted to emphasize a few that I think there is a need for us to revise our teacher education programs beyond just preparing for external reviews. If we are wanting to take seriously the challenge of cognitive justice, and if we want to explore how learning interactions can make a difference on the level of practice, then these are the kinds of topics that should be considered as part of a teacher education program. Right, in closing, the focus on understanding the interactional nature of learning explores agency, subjectivity learning relationships. So I'm reconfirming the point that having a better understanding of the interactional nature of learning, we will also have a better understanding of agency, subjectivity, and how learning relationships can change to accommodate and work towards development of multiple knowledges. Learning interactions as practices of conversation are social actions, and as such, they can be used in the program of cognitive justice. Cognitive justice and teacher education, there are clear implications on levels of education philosophies, worldviews, knowledge content, pedagogies, and so on. Saying that it is not just about inserting some ideas about cognitive justice into teacher education, it is about rethinking, if I can use an important term used by Odora Hoppers, it's about rethinking the implications on levels of education philosophies on in terms of worldviews, knowledge content, and pedagogies. I think Faculty of Education, as a an important resource for processes of curriculum transformation. So I'm hoping that our faculty can play this kind of role in time to come. It also seems that agendas for curriculum transformation are quite invitational, and they would hopefully include researching and reconstituting conversation practices. So may I say a few words of thank you to the University of Johannesburg for my appointment, the workspace I received, the support and all the opportunities, faculty management, my HOD Helen Krieger for all the support and encouragement. It's really a nice place to work at UJ, and given the fact that we are now in the hashtag age, I can see some exciting possibilities. I can just have the sense that this is a watershed time, and I'm very happy to be part of that. Colleagues and students in the department and the faculty, I have super colleagues, and I have super students. My students are, all of them are exceeding me, which is very nice to be in this kind of position where you have to listen, you know, two or three times. So you are really saying, oh, I've never thought about that. And then new concepts come, like for example, I didn't know that mentors do ostensible uncertainty. Yeah, I didn't know that, but my student Aniki actually coined the phrase, and she said, you know what, that is not a bad mentoring conversation action, is to play and do, not play, but do ostensible uncertainty. So now I want to spread the word, you know, about the value of ostensible uncertainty. Of course, my family, they know how I do that already. So I also want to thank academic peers from other institutions. It is just really, for me, a very rewarding life, and that is to interact with academic peers from other institutions. Languages grow, conversations grow, and you really go beyond the limitation of academic work as, you know, just doing teaching and your own bit of research. I also want to express a word of thank to my interaction with adult knowledge holders who share our interest in conversations for learning. And with my colleague Zulu Matabu Zulu, we have a group of knowledge holders in Soweto, and we are working together to develop the understanding of what goes into a learning conversation outside of school. So we are looking at opportunities to observe and to work with knowledge holders when they interact with children outside of school. So it's a wonderful opportunity, and maybe I could quickly say this. There was one interaction between knowledge holder and three boys, but the three boys never said anything. And wasn't that a wonderful learning conversation? At the SAERA conference, there was a presenter who showed such a session to say, bad education. And then another session from China, a lesson from China, a wonderful interaction with little ones asking questions to the teacher and she couldn't answer. Well, we are learning in our project in Soweto that even if learners say nothing, there is a very complex conversation. And we are making excellent progress, I think, in understanding how conversation works and how multiple knowledges come out in very unique ways. Our idea with that project is to learn and to take the learning to schools, to say to schools, well, there are other ways of knowing. There are other ways of conversing about topics. So we can learn from knowledge holders outside of our formal education system. I want to thank close associates, Harm Tillema. He was very keen to be here from Leiden, and then he was advised not to come after all the Paris shootings. So I'm sorry that he's not here, but our workshop on Wednesday will still continue, to mention that. Then also my colleague, my friend Darian Harov, he's my writing tutor. And we come a long way. We did some very interesting work together. When we meet, we tell stories. He's a professional storyteller. And when I sit with him, I tell stories, which is something I don't always do. But it is very nice to have a colleague, doing that. And then my work with Zulu Matabo Zulu, he's a mathematician, but also a very strong knowledge holder in his own right. I find it very inspirational to work with colleagues like that. And then, dan wil ek 'n baie besondere woord van dank uitspreek aan my vrou Leonie en ons vier seuns. I have my four sons here tonight, and I'm so pleased to have them here. Julle is eintlik die rykdom wat ek het, en al die praatjies bly nou maar op die papier, maar die stories wat ek het saam met julle en saam met my hele familie is regtig wonderlik. Ek waardeer die geleentheid dat julle hier is. And then that's of course Zoe, and we have stories about how when you sit next to the ocean, the sea can rain. So we have a conversation, and it's still going on. How is it possible for the sea to rain? So I was just in Afrikaans thanking the family, appreciating the fact that they are here is very special to me. I had my turn, so in terms of conversation, now it's somebody else's turn.
Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. I'm truly privileged and honored to be invited to, I think the word used is to respond, but I'm not going to respond. I'm going to appreciate Gert's, Professor van der Westhuizen's presentation, ladies and gentlemen. Now, as I do so, allow me to thank the acting DVC, Professor Berger, for the invitation and for everything, really. Professor Luke, acting executive dean in the Faculty of Education. Professor Gert from the Westhuizen's family, Leonie and the boys and the grandchildren. Special guests, colleagues, Professor Hopper and other friends of Professor van der Westhuizen. The greatest debate between the West and the East is whether between them has a superior culture. And to prove a point, and archaeologists from the West came up, actually wrote an article in the journal, referee journal, that they dug about 50 feet, and down there the archaeologists, they found a piece of metal wire, copper, that demonstrated that about 1,000 years ago, the West had technology of telephones. And the East person, people not to be outdone, actually came up with evidence also from the archaeologist that they dug actually 200 meters and they found a piece of wire there that demonstrated that they actually had the technology of telephone 2,000 years ago. And then it came the opportunity of the African, and he also produced evidence that he dug about 300 meters and they didn't find anything. And that was evidence that in Africa they had Wi-Fi before. So what Professor Gert has actually done is actually to problematize the idea of knowledges, that it is multiple, it is not just from one source. It resides in multiple resources and so on. Now, Professor Gert, I will not be able to do justice because the instruction is that I should not exceed 5 minutes. So let me see what I can do in 5 minutes. The first minute is to really thank Gert, and that's why I'm here, to really appreciate what he has done for me and to many people that I'm working with. We started working way back in 1997 or so at the old Vista, and he created opportunities for the people like me to start doing research and supervising postgraduate students. And I don't have words to thank him for that. He has always been there, really, to create those spaces. And his presentation today, I think, mirrored the same kind of creating spaces for the alternative, that knowledge that are marginalized, you create opportunities for it to grow and flourish. And it was also through her that I started reading very wonderful references. I will not bore the audience with the how wonderful the readings were. I'm still using them up to this day, and thank you very much. I wanted to thank you for that minute, for you and the family, for everything that you've done for many of us. Now, the second point, the second minute, you presented to me a challenge that you had the opportunity to say something, and now you were saying it's my turn. And my turn, I just have one or two questions, which you don't have to respond to. The first question is, you talk about knowledge as being interactional and so on. Now my question is, how, given that as background, how can we talk about improving learning when the standard is not fixed, when the standard is multiple? I think this is the point that we are bringing forth, that knowledge should be local, should not necessarily be universalized. We should not have Umalusi, we should not have those standards, because the knowledge has to be interactional within the teacher and the learner. And now the second question is, if we don't have the standard which is universal, is that not lowering the bar when we make it possible for all to jump according to what they're able to achieve? I think they I might be misrecognizing your concept of cognitive justice, but I think these are the issues that you raised. And then the last point I would wish to raise on my second minute is, isn't the interactions between nations, cultures, a good starting point for individuals' interactions learning? I think the emphasis that you presented was the interaction between the learner and the mentor, or the learner and the teacher. So my question is, shouldn't we also talk about interaction amongst cultures, which would take the conversation beyond the local and include the global? So I've raised a few questions which I'm hoping we can take up in further conversation. But on the whole, colleagues, my last point is to really appreciate Gert's presentation, because it brought into very clear focus the issues around knowledge, which is local. That sometimes this knowledge, which is local, it's undermined and not recognized, whereas it represents what somebody refers to as powerful knowledge. It's like my own language, you know, it's a powerful knowledge that I dream with, that I communicate my ideas directly, very, very fluently with. But I think your presentation privileges that powerful knowledge, but says you're not saying we should do away with the knowledge of the powerful, but you're saying we need to bring the two together. In as much as I know that I still have to recognize and try to take in the knowledge of the other, I appreciate for that. And the whole idea of cognitive justice, I think I really found it very powerful, and really talking to the heart of many of the issues that we're trying to do as educationists, that we need to recognize the context, the background from which our learners come from, as basis for creating context for success. That if we use that which is foreign as a yardstick to measure everybody's performance, we might be missing the point. And if we really are interested in improving learner performance, we need to bring that particular context, their experiences, their fears, and aspirations into the classroom as basis for teaching. I really appreciated that. And in very many ways, I found your presentation talking to the concept that I like most of community cultural wealth. I think the concept that you also brings to the conversation, that the knowledge that is tacit, that we bring from our own everyday experiences, could be used as a powerful platform to launch other forms of knowing and knowledge. You have talked about the role of the local versus the global, and I think you have really done justice to that. And in conclusion, really, I think you have charted a new dimension beyond that which we have become accustomed to. Maybe on the basis of your presentation, now we have an instrument to challenge forms of domination in terms of knowledge that have excluded, especially the knowledge of the majority. In those few words, ladies and gentlemen, allow me to thank Professor Gert for the wonderful presentation. Thank you.
I've asked for just 1 minute, colleagues, to not to pursue the conversation, but just to note in closing that here at UJ, the topic of cognitive justice has been presented by Catherine Odora Hopper's end of last year as a challenge. She made a presentation here in this venue challenging UJ to consider and to respond to the imperatives of cognitive justice. So my talk was a small step in a certain direction, but I am wanting to say that this is a shared challenge that we have, and I trust that with all the new discussions on the agenda about curriculum development, about decolonizing knowledge, all of that will really be the opportunity for you, Jay, to take the conversation that was started by Catherine here last year, to take that forward.
Ladies and gentlemen, join me in thanking again Professor Gert for a fascinating, very interesting, very relevant, as you pointed out now in this last minute, because you actually stole what I wanted to say, that it is very relevant now for the climate UJ is in currently, and higher education, to take these suggestions forward in terms of curriculum reform. And so that this is coming at the right time. But it has been such a privilege to, for me, it is actually the highlight for me, I must say, in the last couple of weeks to have had this opportunity to listen to you. And just to emphasize again how privileged UJ is to have someone of your caliber at UJ. So thank you for an absolutely fascinating presentation. Thought-provoking and so well presented. Thank you. And for you, Professor, as well. Spot on response. You said it's not a response, but it was spot on. And we also really would like to thank you. So, colleagues, I'm going to do the ask the Dean now to join me in roving. And then we invite you to join us for refreshments in the adjacent room next door for some drinks and eats. Thank you. Kurt will do that.
Thank you.
We will now leave this venue, and Prof. Gert will wait outside for your congratulations.
The University of Johannesburg. Rethink. Reinvent.